call. I'd like to say hello to all of my many friends, also to my many enemies. Once again, this is another episode of Roosevelt Sounds Off. This, of course, is your friend, brother, and humble servant, Roosevelt. And I would like to thank everybody for tuning in to my YouTube channel. Thank every single body for whatever it is that you do for the channel. Watching, commenting, subscribing is very much appreciated from me to you. If you're not a subscriber currently to Roosevelt Sounds Off, please do me a big favor. Hit that subscribe button along with the bell icon. This way you'll be notified whenever I upload new content or go live here on YouTube. Okay, let's get into this. A couple of weeks ago, there was a story that played on, I think it's Channel 2 News, about one of our local, so-called, let's just say, local police officers. Oh yeah, he's at it again. Officer James Hunt. Now, as many of you all know, that you probably saw him in a video about a year ago harassing some black youths in a park, talking about that I don't only shoot, these are his words, and I can only quote him, I don't only shoot MFs, no, I kill MFs. This goes along with the, constant, bad climate of the Chicago Police Department of, murdering black people. You know, I can kind of speak on this because even though my situation is a little bit mundane, compared to a whole lot of other stuff Chicago Police Department could be doing. I'm also a past victim of Chicago police corruption. So therefore, if I get a little bit of a taste of it, I think I know how it feels possibly to get like a bigger taste. Because he was harassing these youths in a park. I talked about him sometime last year here on the channel. And they did a news story on him. And comes to find out that he really did actually kill somebody. And, just like police officers in Chicago and police officers all over this nation do, he, ended up getting away with it. We're living in a time where the Chicago Police Department, they can spend more time trying to investigate what happened to so-called local celebrities like a Jesse Smollett before they take the time to go investigate one of their own for wrongdoing. So therefore, right now, I'm going to cut to this particular clip, and I will be back with what I think of the whole thing. And so far, stay tuned for the clip.
You said you trying to chew.
When that utterance went viral,
that's him.
Bonnet Jernigan.
You heard him boasting.
You said you trying to chew.
I kill.
It's the officer she'd looked for since 2014, the one who killed.
This is Deshaun.
Her grandson, Deshaun Pittman.
How did he have a bullet in the back?
Miss Jernigan hadn't much time to prepare for this, her first interview.
This is crazy.
I connected with her just after picking up the autopsy report.
Can you imagine? Oh my God. Look at all of these.
A through J.
Oh my God.
1 through 10. Shot. 10.
Oh my God.
Times.
Who shoots a human being like this? Oh my God.
You said you're trying to shoot.
I kill.
Let's begin on July 3rd, 2018.
He said, yeah, I kill.
You don't even got your name tag. It's Hunt, 11442. No, there you go.
Hunt, his last name, badge 11442. Officer James A. Hunt engaged Kenneth Lee.
Well, I'm in the middle of the street. It's kind of like
in his first interview, said Officer Hunt.
And you just tried to hit me with the cop?
Don't try to film me, dude.
Responding to a scene accelerated.
That's when the video started recording. He said, we about to go on Snapchat. I'm like, you don't have a Snapchat.
You don't even got a Snapchat, bro.
Yeah, dude, it's called
He like, yeah, dude, it's called your mom.
It's called I your mom.
Yeah, he's saying that's his Snapchat name. I your mom.
That's fairly offensive.
Yeah.
All right, stop talking to me.
So in this day and age, after Laquan McDonald's case, as the city tries to heal and tries to rebuild that trust,
we're going
to
play at the park.
You have an officer like this who is doing the complete opposite. Attorney Jeff Nesland is uniquely qualified to make such a statement. He represented the family of Laquan McDonald, shot 16 times. Murdered was the verdict by CPD officer Jason Van Dyke. He's now representing Kenneth Lee.
When officers are subjected to continued training of de-escalation. This appears to be a master class in escalation.
I already said it, retard.
You can have all the training in de-escalation. You can put body cams on everyone. You're not going to have change unless you get the right individuals for the job that want to serve the public.
I don't give a about what you do. Y'all get shot at me. You all that other
Yeah.
How's little G doing? Asked Hunt. Little G, Gregory Livingston, a recently murdered neighborhood youth.
Yeah, he giggled while he said it.
How did officer that got killed go? Which one? The one that got shot.
Lee bit back about the murder of Commander Paul Bauer.
You feel that was a threat? I just think you said, we can die, which means I'm going to take that as a threat.
I can die. That is not a threat.
Hands.
Thank you.
Are
you arresting me?
Yep. For assault.
I ain't doing nothing.
Okay.
Assault to a police officer and jaywalking.
Have a seat, brother.
The charges were quickly dropped. Then?
You believe Officer Hunt further retaliated against your client by arresting him on a second occasion?
When the charges were pending for this assault, he was rearrested and charged with an alleged retail theft from a Walgreens that was also dismissed.
I already said it, retard. It's called mama.
I can only imagine that it's the tip of the iceberg.
Craig Futterman, a clinical professor of law at the University of Chicago. In less than 6 years as CPD Officer Hunt, he has 8 accusations of misconduct, false arrest, racial, verbal abuse, and more, and at least 16 use of force reports. That's a self-reporting mechanism when a cop uses, for example, a taser. When measured against his years of service, he's in the top 95th percentile and top 99.9 percentile. That, per the watchdog group, the Invisible Institute. Hunt began his law enforcement career at the Pontiac Police Department. He resigned soon after, per Pontiac PD, to take a position with the Frankfort Police Department, where he resigned after a mere year and 2 weeks. Fully 3 years later, he joined CPD. The first complaint lodged against Hunt at CPD a bit over a year later. 40 days after that, he shot and killed Deshaun Pittman, after Pittman allegedly shot and killed a man and pointed his weapon at Hunt. That last fact, per Hunt himself. All that while Officer Hunt was still within his 18-month probationary period. Right now, per CPD, Officer Hunt is full duty status. In 2017, Hunt made more than $130,000.
What's up, man? You hit my shoe.
The mentality that's shown in this video highlights to me more than anything else the critical need for this consent decree in Chicago for oversight, external oversight.
This one said to me, he was like, you wind up like the guy who got dead. There's snipers out here. Y'all wind up dead.
Oh, yeah?
So I took that as an assault.
In all the video we reviewed, we heard nothing remotely like that.
Were you surprised to find out that Officer Hunt had indeed killed somebody before?
Not at all.
Chicago police shoot and kill a man suspected in a shooting in the East Chatham neighborhood.
August 24th, 2014, per news reports.
Two people were shooting at each other.
Police say Deshaun Pittman shot and killed the other man. Pittman's friends say in self-defense. Officers arrive. Former Fraternal Order of Police spokesperson Pat Camden.
You've got 4 young officers that responded.
Only one young officer fired his weapon, James Hunt, 11 times. Pittman was within 5 feet after Hunt said Pittman aimed in his direction. That's per the Independent Police Review Authority report obtained by Lee's legal team. The incident happened in August of 2014. IPRA's follow-up, its second interview with Hunt, nearly 3 years later. IPRA's conclusion, P.O. Hunt's use of deadly force was reasonable, as initially were all but one of the hundreds of CPD officer-involved shootings investigated by IPRA between 2007 and 2014.
We was all alone.
The autopsy notes, unfortunately, both remains were removed before investigators' arrival. Why were both bodies removed before medical examiner investigators arrived?
You gotta be dead.
When both were dead, and it appears no aid was rendered, why the haste? We don't know. In the end, it was officers' words versus a dead 17-year-old. And it was, and is, case closed.
Did they ever say which bullet actually killed him? The first, the second, the third, the fourth, the fifth, the sixth. Which one? Did he feel all of them?
Okay, hopefully you enjoyed that clip. And that falls under the category of fair use. Sorry about the noise and everything before, only I'm working on and doing this video during the day. And, you know, it's a lot of noise and everything going on. I mean, I guess that's how come, you know, I do most of my good work, you know, late at night, believe it or not. But, anyway, as you can see, that I think that this is like a killer cop. In this, Chicago police officer, James Hunt, is out of control. It needs to be stopped. I mean, but it's just so hard, it seems like, for the Chicago Police Department to discipline and do something with one of their own, even when one of their own still continues to hurt people, still continues to harass people, and just say whatever it is that he wants to. And, I mean, even the Department of Justice did, investigation a few years ago about the Chicago Police Department. I know because I was there and I was one who testified before the Department of Justice here in Chicago. And after they listened to all of us, I mean, because it was like an investigation that took weeks, you know, where they investigated the department and then they interviewed the community and all of the other kind of stuff. It took weeks for this to get done. And after they had done everything, after they investigated, their conclusion came up to that the Chicago Police Department is a wicked criminal organization that's racist and that's separatist, that's all of that. I just cannot believe that, you know, Chicago Police Department is operating, you know, just like, you know, it is and has been for years. And I really believe, even though me and other people in the community don't really have any kind of good solid proof and everything of it, you know, all of these murders that we see here in the city of Chicago, you know, because I get a whole lot of people, especially my critics, who always tell me, Roosevelt, how come you're always so hard on police, but not hard on, you know, the other black youths killing each other? I mean, I've talked about, I've talked about, you know, what we do and some of our bad behavior as well. But, you know, just like I tell everybody, that just because I, you know, might happen to go and get drunk and then run out of a bar and then fall over a table and a couple of chairs and then fall all the way down the stairs does not give you the right to kick me in my head once I've landed at the bottom of those stairs.
So, yeah, I've talked about and everything that what we do, because truly, I can understand that us as, you know, black people and black youths and everything all have a problem. And I think that it starts, you know, sort of like, you know, in the home where, you know, a whole lot of the parents these days are younger and younger. And, you know, so they raise their children as being, you know, more of their friend than, you know, trying to be a parent. I mean, you know, and yesterday, you know, for example, I get on a CTA bus and there's a bunch, you know, I sometimes hate to come out of the house in between the hours of 2:30 and 4 o'clock because I have two schools around me. I have an elementary school down the street and I have a high school also down the street. And this is when the heathens, that's what I call them, are getting out of school. Case in point, that it was like a bunch of 8 and 9 year olds yesterday who are getting on the bus and everything and just cussing to the top of their lungs. And, you know, one boy or something, you know, he couldn't be no more than 8, 19 years old. Up there, you know, telling another boy, talking about, you know, all kinds of stuff. And I'm gonna go ahead and use the language that he used. You know, I guess he met one other boy from one other school. Then the first thing he says, "Yo, nigga, what's up, man? Hey, tell me, what school you from? Man, you got a bitch? You got a woman? You got a girlfriend? Does she got a fat ass or a flat ass? Man, golly, if she got a fat ass, you're supposed to grab that bitch and be like, And this is only an 8 or 9 year old. When I was 8 or 9 years old, I never knew anything of how to talk like this and how to act this way. But you're seeing it a whole lot now, younger and younger. And, I mean, this is our future. I hate to see what this young kid is going to act like when he becomes a teenager. Because, you know, one day next week, and I'm working on it, that I am going to put together a documentary or documentary style type of a thing or expose on the music business. And I'm going to show what hip-hop music was designed for. It was not designed for your enjoyment or for you to nod your head and everything to the beat. I'm going to show you how there was a plan and there was a plot through hip-hop music to put young black men in prison. Oh yeah, I'm going to show that to you. So stay tuned for that video coming up in the next week or two. So I said all of that to say this, that I could understand that we have a whole lot of bad behavior in the black community. I could probably give you that. But at the same time, I think the way that, you know, blacks have been treated within this country, you know, first of all, through slavery and through, you know, Jim Crow, you know, the dangers of being the last hired, first fired. I think that this has contributed to some of the bad behavior that we see, you know, in the relation in between, you know, black people and police, especially the Chicago Police Department, has never been good. And I mean, only thing that we see, I mean, and one thing I hate about the police department is, like I said, that they cared much more about a Jesse Smollett and, you know, catering to the needs in this so-called staged attack on Jesse Smollett than they care about the average citizen. I mean, it's kidnappings in this city that have gone unsolved. Missing people that have never been found. Murders that have not been solved. And the only thing the Chicago Police Department cared about at the time was trying to see what happened to Jesse Smollett. Only thing is, he ended up, like, you know, staging the whole thing. So it really, you know, didn't happen like he said he did. But one good thing about it is they have 16 counts of felony, you know, federal charges against him for his bad behavior. So hopefully he gets locked up and thrown under the jail just like any other criminal. But a whole lot of these murders in Chicago, you know, we might hear about it once or twice on the news. Then after we don't hear about it anymore, you know, you don't hear anything else. And, you know, it's only like one or two times in the conclusion is always the same. That there is no suspect in custody. So many of us begin to start thinking, even though we don't have any concrete proof, could the Chicago Police Department be behind black men being murdered in Chicago? Because it's a known fact that they have been known to take guns off of people, and then they go in, you know, some corrupt or crooked officers might be known to deal and do business with gang members and put these same guns that they have arrested people for and the same guns that they have confiscated, put them back out on the street to commit a murder with? Or could the police themselves be committing the murder of black people? The next clip I am going to play for you is a clip of Dr. Umar Abdullah Johnson. And even he is coming up with a theory on why we have so many unsolved murder cases here within the Chicago area. Now, I know a whole lot of people, you know, have the differences with Dr. Umar Johnson. You know, me, myself, you know, I do as well, because I have found him to be somewhat of a kind of like a charlatan or great liar, because he said that he was going to build a school to help misguided black youth. This was some years ago, and the school, or so-called school anyway, if you will, has not surfaced yet. But I believe in this particular theory, he possibly could be correct, because a whole lot of us who live here in Chicago have been saying this about the Chicago Police Department for years, and it's never been looked into, it's never been investigated, and has nothing ever happened. So this next clip is of Dr. Umar Johnson, and I'll come back with the rest of this video after Dr. Umar Johnson gives you his take on the murders of black youths in the city of Chicago, possibly by the Chicago Police Department, and we're going to take it home. Stay tuned for the clip.
I believe before this is all said and done with Chicago, I believe before it's all said and done with it, I don't know how many years from now we're going to find this out, but I very much believe that it's going to be revealed at some point in time that there was a mercenary army that was hired and employed by either the state government of Illinois or the city government or possibly even the federal government to go in and systematically reduce the population of black folks in Chicago. There's no way you're going to convince me that all of these murders are the result of angry black males when you have cameras on every major intersection in Chicago. Right. I spend a lot of time in Chicago. There's no way you're going to get away with a murder in that city and it not be recorded. This is being orchestrated by the government.
That is a clip coming from Dr. Umar Johnson, who calls himself the Prince of Pan-Africanism, and that falls under the category of fair use. In conclusion, I would like to say that I think that the Chicago Police Department needs to get police officers like Officer James Hunt off of the street, especially when they have already admitted to hurting people and to killing people. And they have all, because Officer James Hunt has all of these civilian complaints and everything against him. And, you know, he's just been put out on the street. And you find a whole lot of officers who have a whole lot of civilian complaints against them. And they're still, you know, let back out on the street to possibly do some more damage. And I think that the Chicago Police Department needs to really clean house of some of these crooked and corrupt officers. And I get so tired of everybody always telling me, well, you know, telling me all the time,
Roosevelt, you put everybody in one box. You say that they're all the same. Then ain't none of them no good.
Yeah, I mean, I probably have said things like that. Because sometimes, you know, you come to that conclusion, first of all, after having a bad track record with Chicago Police in a criminal organization like the Chicago Police Department, which has a bad track record throughout history, you know, back in the 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s. I mean, look at the John Birch case, for God's sake. You know, a police commander who tortured confessions out of black men and caused some black men to be put on death row. Look at the Robert Russ shooting. Look at the Rekia Boyd shooting. Look at the Ronald Johnson, Ronnie Man shooting. Look at the Laquan McDonald case. I mean, with the Chicago Police Department, we can go on and on and on. I mean, it's even happened personally to people who I know. My godson was unjustly, had his rights violated by a Chicago police officer, Officer Marcos Hernandez, over on the west side. His cousin was beat up by a Chicago police officer, Officer Matthew Jackson, who lives on the west side. Because his cousin had to go to the bathroom, I guess. And then, I guess instead of waiting to go to the bathroom, Officer Jackson has like a big house on the west side. You know, I've seen it and everything before. And I guess he goes into this big driveway, because it's a big driveway in this house, because this is like a big, like, mansion type of house on the west side of Chicago. And I guess the driveway is so big that it actually looks like an alley, because that's what he thought. So as soon as he goes back there, Officer Jackson comes out of his house and starts beating him and everything with his gun and all of that kind of stuff. And then, you know, they ended up putting him in the hospital because Officer Jackson beat him that badly. And then it's the same as every single kind of case involving police. If they shoot you and you survive, they beat you up and you survive, they will not let your family come and talk to you. They will not let your family come and visit you. Why? That is so stupid to me. I will never ever understand. If I live to get 1,000 years old, I will never understand that one. I wish somebody would come and explain that to me. Why, if you are in trouble with a police officer, or if they think that a police officer is the victim of something by a citizen, they will not allow your family to see you or visit you. They would not let his family see him. Then Officer Jackson knocked out his teeth, had his head and everything swollen, and then they put two or three felony charges on Little Nate. That's what we call him, Little Nate. And he is the one who gets beat up. They put, you know, assault and battery on a peace officer and battery on a police officer, both which are felonies. And he's the one who gets beat up. To me, this Officer Jackson overstepped his bounds and overstepped his authority. And the thing is, he wasn't even on duty. And even one of our Cook County commissioners in a meeting talked to Officer Jackson. And this is all allegations of what I was told, because I wasn't there to hear it. But from what I'm hearing, the Cook County commissioner walked up to Officer Jackson and asked the man, what happened in this case? And Officer Jackson was like, man, come on, commissioner, man, you know me. He's like, yeah, I do know you. What happened? And Officer Jackson himself said that he wished that the family of Little Nate would stop complaining, because instead of beating him up or pistol whipping him, he should have shot him. And Officer Jackson murdered someone 5 years ago and got away with it. And all of this while he's off duty. Look at the Rekia Boyd case, who was murdered by Dante Servin. Pretty much in that same neighborhood as Officer Jackson, because Dante Servin has a house right off of 15th and Kedzie, a couple of blocks away from Officer Jackson, across the street from Douglas Park. All of this kind of stuff when they're off duty. To me, a police officer should not have this kind of power when they are off duty. Because that's the key. You're off duty. So this murderous culture and murderous history, the Chicago Police Department needs to stop. Or else the people are going to rise up. And this city will burn if something is not done about officers like Officer James Hunt. So, I'm going to get ready to close this video. If you like this video, do me a favor. Give me a thumbs up. I would greatly appreciate it. And tune in next time for another episode of Roosevelt Sounds Off. And for now, until next time, peace and blessings to all. Thank you.